What was cinema like in the 80s? How has cinema changed since the 80s? How did political circumstances affect film at the time? How were men and women portrayed differently on screen, and how is it done differently in movies today? How was violence represented differently? How have different genres changed and developed? These are all questions that are incredibly relevant to all aspects of film and filmmaking. However, nobody really knows the answer. Why is that? Simply put, I think it's because there isn't an answer. If you ask two people how cinema has changed since the 80s, you're definitely going to get two different answers.
I mean, if you look at a lot of the blockbusters of the 80s, and obviously you had the stuff that was more spectacle-driven as well, but a lot of it's like the Spielberg stuff and things like that. It was all about character. It was all about getting to know the people in the film, like, you know, us identifying with them. We obviously, like, you know, we cared about what happened to them. And I think we did get to a point where, you know, the narrative of films moved very quickly, in more recent years, and I don't think I can think that can be detrimental to narrative.
I hope that watching this video can shed some light on the subject. Jaws and The Meg are two perfect examples of how much cinema has changed in the 43 years between the making of the two films, particularly the differences in production techniques, special effects and the representation of characters. Possibly the scariest scene in the whole film, where Hooper dives in looking for the shark but ends up finding Ben Gardner's boat and his dead body, which literally jumps out at him, was all added in the edit. Believing the preview audience's screams not to be loud enough, during the scuba diving scene where the shark victim's head appears through the boat, Spielberg reshot the scene in Jaws editor's Verna Field swimming pool. Paying for the shoot himself, he assembled a crew and used a gallon of milk to give the backyard swimming pool the murky look of the waters around Martha's Vineyard, where the rest of Jaws was filmed. I hope he also paid to clean the pool afterwards. Overall filming of Jaws was very difficult for everyone, as Steven Spielberg will now explain.
When I first hear the word Jaws, you know, I just think of a period in my life when I was much younger than I am right now. And I think because I was younger, I was more courageous, or I was more stupid. I'm not sure which. So when I think of Jaws, I think about courage and stupidity. And I think of both of those things existing underwater.
Wherever you were on the island, you could hear the radio mics. And they were always saying, "The shark is not working. The shark is not working. Repeat, the shark is not working." No matter where you were, and for months.
With his main villain unavailable for certain shots, Steven had to improvise and used the camera as the shark, filming as if from the predator's point of view. Due to the many problems the movie encountered, the planned number of shooting days ballooned from 55 to a staggering 159 days.
Now, if I tried to verbally explain just a few of the differences between the making of The Meg and Jaws, we would definitely be here all day. So to save us all some time, I'll let John Turteltaub explain.
The Meg tagging sequence was done out in the Harakee Gulf and then also in the tank. We'd constructed a rig off the side of one of the boats that basically dragged him through the water, and it was controllable enough that we could have a crane and camera team on there to film him. And then we also did it in the tank behind me on winches, where he was pulled under the water at different speeds with different camera positions. So yeah, it was an exciting sequence. And also did a rig with him where he was kicking the shark in the head, and we had him on a ratchet that was pulling him up out of the water.
And 18 meters around. It's huge.
As you can see, there are major differences between Spielberg's nightmare of using an animatronic shark, which would never work properly and going massively over time and budget. The Meg obviously had difficulties filming, however with new techniques and different ways of training actors, etc., John Turteltaub definitely had things easier than Steven Spielberg. Aside from the obvious CGI and technical production changes between the two films, we can also see some very prominent role changes for men and women. Jaws was a very male-dominated setting, with Martin Brody, Matt Hooper and Captain Quint being the three main characters who tackle the task of killing the shark and of course ultimately do so. Watching the Meg, I noticed some huge differences. The role of the female characters were much stronger, very independent and more than equal to all of the male characters. Jax, for example, was the designer of the underwater research sub Manor One. She was at the very core of the decision-making and helped come up with the solutions of how to kill the Meg. Also, female lead Su-Yin was an incredibly strong, independent and intelligent woman. She volunteered to go 13,000 metres underwater and save the sub at the beginning of the story. She went down in the shark cage on her own to try and inject the shark with a powerful injection. In movies before, and even sometimes in The Meg, the man would always be the hero of the story, especially in Jason Statham films. However, Su-Yin is more than capable of everything that Jonas does, and continuously proves that during the film. However, despite The Meg being a huge step forward in the development of changes in roles for women in film, whilst watching I got a strong vibe that the male character always had to be the ultimate hero. For example, after the boat was capsized by the shark, Jax and Dr. Heller were both stuck in the middle of the sea, and they knew that only one of them was going to survive. So Heller attracted the shark towards him, which eventually results in him being eaten. We see the same thing happen between Jonas and Su-Yin. When Su-Yin goes down in the cage, she ends up literally being inside the Megalodon's mouth after she injects it. As soon as Jonas hears about it, he dives in, breaks the cage and pulls her to safety. This is proof that despite both Jax and Su-Yin are both strong and independent individuals, come the end of the film, they both ultimately need to be saved by a man. The way men are represented in The Meg is also very interesting. Jason Statham has feelings, emotions, and at one point Su-Yin has to actually save him. In previous Statham films, he's always been very physically and mentally strong, and he is in The Meg too. But in the first scene in the film, you see that Jonas Taylor has a conscience. He has to think about the whole crew and not be the ultimate hero. Even though he's still the saviour and brought back 11 men, he couldn't save everyone. Later in the film, we see a scene where he's discussing how he lives whilst knowing that two men die because he wouldn't get to them, which shows that he has an emotional side too. To begin with, Jaws looks to be an ultimate action hero tough guy film, showcasing how audiences expect men to behave in a disaster. Women play a very little role in the film. Women in Jaws are either mothers, wives, or are victims in the film. The three male characters, despite all of them coming from very different backgrounds, each go into the middle of the ocean to hunt down and kill the shark. However, the film often questions the viewer's opinion about how men are portrayed in cinema. In movies before and after Jaws, men were often shown as invincible hard men who could not be killed by anything or anyone, simply because they're men. And in many ways it tends to tackle the question of male helplessness. At the beginning of the film, a woman asks a man to go swimming with her, however he's far too drunk to get off the beach, and whilst Chris is swimming she is attacked and killed by the shark. Throughout the whole movie there are a lot of pointers to how men are not invincible and are in fact incredibly susceptible to the dangers around them. Whether it was Hooper being petrified when the dead body falls out of the boat, Captain Quint's very undignified ending, or right at the film's climax when Brady shoots the shark stood in the middle of a sinking boat. Jaws was and is still today a highly successful horror film, and it was the highest grossing film of all time until it was surpassed by George Lucas's Star Wars in 1977. It kick-started the summer blockbuster trend, which set the tone for films like Star Wars, Indiana Jones, and even movies made today like Mamma Mia and Avengers. Whether you like Jaws or not, there's no arguing the fact that it'll always be considered a classic piece of cinema's illustrious history. Batman and The Dark Knight are two fantastic examples of how much cinema has changed and how political circumstances which affect the whole world can have a huge impact on cinema, and how the same story can be told differently by two of the best directors of their generations. Despite the two films telling the same story, Tim Burton went for a very fantasy-based film which is evident in the backdrops that seem to be morals, and over-the-top characters like Jack Nicholson's brilliant portrayal of the Joker. In The Dark Knight, Christopher Nolan uses a very grounded and gritty tone, making it seem more realistic. The similarities between the two movies begin with the Joker. Granted, they are the main villain in each movie, and yes, they both take similar actions to take over Gotham. But that's about where the similarities stop. Heath Ledger's Joker is simply a bad man, or as Alfred explains it,
"Some men just want to watch the world burn."
We're never really sure of his motivations, and we never know who he really is. A lot of the time, we're never really convinced of his truthfulness. The best villains are always the ones that maintain a mysterious and conniving air. Heath Ledger's portrayal of the Joker proves this. Jack Nicholson's Joker is much more traditional. He's animated, over the top, and almost amusing at times. The main point is we know his motives and reasoning. He's simply out for revenge. Revenge against Michael Keaton's Batman, and against the whole of Gotham City for turning their back on him. That by no means makes him any less of a threat. In fact, it makes his disguise all the more frightening. It's hard to believe that such a recognisable actor as Jack Nicholson could truly disappear into a role, but in Batman he was so convincing that he really did. Another big difference is the way Batman and Bruce Wayne is portrayed in both films. Michael Keaton hardly speaks as Batman, making him much more menacing to criminals and the mob. Christian Bale tends to speak an awful lot when he's Batman, and for the most part it takes you out of the movie. It's understandable why he would have to change his voice, but I'm sure audiences would gladly suspend their disbelief to not suffer through Christian Bale talking like he's got marbles in his mouth. On the other hand, Christian Bale is much more convincing as Bruce Wayne. He can easily, convincingly play the billionaire playboy philanthropist, while Michael Keaton never really feels like Bruce Wayne. He makes for an awesome Batman, but Christian Bale definitely wins as Bruce Wayne. Now, of course, the one overriding major difference between The Dark Knight and Batman is the filming and production techniques. Once again, it would take me forever and a day to explain. So, Christopher Nolan, over to you.
Opening the film with an IMAX sequence seemed just a terrific way to make an impression with the format and the audience, really throw them into the action. And when we came to shoot this prologue sequence, this bank heist, we'd never used the IMAX cameras before, we'd never used the technology before, and so there were a lot of challenges.
On the top you can see four frames of 35 millimeter, and of course it goes through the projector up and down, and that's actually a print down of IMAX photography, and IMAX goes through the projector horizontally, and that's four frames of IMAX. It's about 9 times bigger, so that's why you get incredible resolution in the IMAX format.
There's a different way you compose for IMAX. Because you're putting it on a screen that's 8 stories high, your vision doesn't naturally go to the top of the screen. So we kind of throw away a lot of what's in the top portion of the screen. Focus is much more critical. It's shallower depth of field, so the focus puller's really got to be on his game.
Keeping the actors in focus is much more difficult in IMAX. The area in the frame that the actor would be in focus is much more shallow. In a normal movie situation, if an actor is maybe 12 feet from the camera, you'll have an area that could be in focus of maybe 1 or 2 feet.
He would talk to me about the nature of the sounds he was playing with, this idea of sort of razor blades on strings, this idea of tension and extraordinary tension, just mounting and mounting. The idea of the punk influence that I think Heath had absorbed in the feel of the character, getting the feel of that into the music.
There's no denying that The Dark Knight was highly influenced by the tragic event of 9/11, and I think it's still the only film made that tackles the aftermath of the tragedy using a noir style. Noir reflects what's happening in the world and how real people feel about it. The Dark Knight does this by using post-9/11 feelings. In the film, Batman isn't the defining hero of the story. He's an alienated outsider, which is another noir technique. The film reflects how people felt afterwards, that some laws had to be broken for the greater good. Dark Knight also mirrors a cynical, by any means necessary attitude of American people at the time. Noir films in general often take place in gloomy, dark settings full of crime and corruption, and that's the perfect description of Gotham. Even the prologue bank robbery scene at the start mirrors the post-9/11 feelings that if the government can't help, the police can't help, and then we will have to help ourselves because desperate times call for desperate measures. On reflection of films of the present era, it becomes very apparent just how much some filmmakers today, I won't mention any names, Michael Bay, depend on the technological advances that we have access to today. We only have to look at the Star Wars franchise as proof of this. George Lucas had massive success with the first or last 3 films of the story, but he was aware of the technological advances that were approaching, and his gamble of waiting 20 plus years to finish them certainly paid off. The same can be said of Superman films. All credit to Christopher Reeve, but Henry Cavill certainly had the edge, or was it just clever editing? I think that the use of technical equipment and programs that are available today do have a massive influence on the film industry. It's generally easier to produce the wow factor into a film and create something amazing and not have to solely rely on actors' abilities. Film is a reflection of society, both present and past. I think the film and its innovations sometimes has to catch up to society, but sometimes it leads society too. Movies are stories. Movies are people who come out with ideas about something they want to say, something they want to tell someone. Movies are a form of communication, and that communication, those stories, come from societies. Not just where society is presently and what it's doing now, but where society has been. It's been that way for as long as film and cinema have been around. Movies are different things to different people. That's what is so incredible about them. To me personally, movies are about escapism. Movies are about sitting in a cinema watching something, watching a story unfold with people I don't know, watching that happen and emoting an emotion, knowing that for those 2 hours when I walk into that cinema, I don't have to worry about what's going on outside. I lose myself in what I'm watching. Movies can educate too. They tell us things we could never have known. They tell us things we might not know. And they give us a way to explore the past, the present, and the future.